Okay, well, it is 7 o'clock. I'm going to go ahead and get started. We're already streaming for those at home. And we're going to finish up in chapter 7 tonight. I don't think we'll get into 8. If we do, we'll move into there. But I think there's plenty to talk about and discuss here in chapter 7. We're going to pick it up actually in verse 13. As we read along, you can see up here the two topics essentially. But before we do that, we'll go ahead and start with a word of prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for your word, thankful for your son, and we are mindful of the distress that is going on around the world because of the pandemic and then the distress going on in our country over the death of, you know, a black man, and then all of the rioting and things that have gotten created a lot of chaos and havoc. We hope, Father, that our country and our leaders will help find peace and find unity and love and compassion and mercy, that we can truly love one another as you would want us to. We hope, Father, that especially for your children, that we fulfill that great commandment of the law to love our neighbors as ourselves. Help us, Father, to overcome these trials and these distressing times. And help us, Father, to always shine the light of your Son. We pray all these things and the thanks for being able to come together tonight to study your word. And we're thankful the peace that we have to do that. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay. So I'm going to go ahead and read to start with, just from 13 to 18. And really this whole section I have highlighted to discuss. And so I want to hear your thoughts. I know the people at home can't really hear you guys so much, and are, you know, it's hard to kind of go back and forth on mics and everything. But I don't want the class just to be me talking about it. So I do want to hear your thoughts about these things. And so let me go ahead and read to start. Consider the work of God. Who can make straight what he has made crooked? In the day of prosperity, be joyful. And in the day of adversity, consider God has made the one as well as the other, so that man may not find out anything that will be after him. In my vain life, I have seen everything. There is a righteous man who perishes in his righteousness, and there is a wicked man who prolongs his life in his evil doing. Be not overly righteous, and do not make yourself too wise. Why should you destroy yourself? Be not overly wicked, neither be a fool. Why should you die before your time? It is good that you should take hold of this, and from that withhold not your hand, for the one who fears God shall come out from both of them. Okay, so considering God's works, the prosperity we have comes from God, but also the adversity we have. And so both the good and the bad, very much like Job responds, right? At the beginning of Job, when everything, he loses everything, and he essentially says that, you know, the Lord has given and the Lord has taken away. And so, and I know we often in that book, we spend a lot of time talking about, well, it wasn't God who took it away, it was the devil. But, and yet, God is the one who removed the barrier to allow the devil to do it. And so he's telling us here that we need to consider the day of adversity still from the hand of God. And whether it's Satan who did it and God has simply allowed it, in some ways that's almost semantics, isn't it? It's kind of, it still happened to you and God still allowed it to happen. And so he's kind of telling us we have to really think about those things. But the first thing is, notice that he's telling you when good things happen, that's not the time to sit and consider. Well, bad things might happen later. No, just enjoy. When the good happens, enjoy. Don't be surprised, though, when the bad happens, when difficulties come. And that's when it's time to consider. Well, I've had some good. Now I've had to have some tough times. And that's kind of the way it goes. It's kind of that is the pattern of life. So just thoughts about that, considering the hand of God and his prosperity and adversity in our lives. Questions, thoughts? Answers? Conundrums?
Any advice for those people who tend to be those warriors? Everything's going well. Something's about to happen. That's really bad.
As you said, when I read it earlier, I was thinking of... we used to love watching the show Everybody Loves Raymond. And so Raymond in the show is a classic warrior who... Everything is going great, and he's like, what's going to happen next? Next bad, something's coming bad. But the truth is, that's true. There is something coming bad. And so I think, kind of being a bit of that worrier person, that God's teaching about enjoying the good things, to me, frees me up to simply enjoy when good things are happening and when I have them. But with an understanding, you know, bad's going to come. And that's okay. But it's still okay for me to enjoy the good right now. And it's also okay for me to enjoy the good right now when somebody else is having adversity. Because if we were to never have any joy when there was anybody having adversity, could any of us ever have joy? We wouldn't be able to, would we? There's always adversity happening to somebody, somewhere. And if that consumes us from enjoying the good things that we have, then I think we're missing one of the gifts God has given us. That's one of the things he's telling us in this book. It is his gift to enjoy the fruit of our hands, the fruit of our work, the fruit of our lives. And so we need to, if we want to be godly, we have to enjoy. And I think joy also takes into consideration where that comes from. That real joy isn't like, wow, look how great I am, but look at this moment that I have, look at this opportunity I have, and this is great because God has given me this opportunity. And so that joy also leads to, I think, a great deal of thanksgiving, you know, and gratefulness that he's talking about here. So I don't know that I don't worry about stuff. I do tend to not worry about stuff coming in as much anymore. But for me, being a recovering perfectionist, some of the teachings I had on perfectionism is a way to simply make yourself unhappy. Because you can never really be perfect, and so it really is a way that just ends up making you unhappy. But accepting that things aren't perfect is actually what kind of has freed me from the worry. And then for me anyway, trying to get rid of making everything right. And generally an understanding that it's not always, I'm not going to get all my ducks in a row and then everything will be fine from then on. But that was my concept. And I think that's actually the concept of a lot of people. They keep thinking they're going to get everything in their life straightened out. And then they'll be able to go on and do all the wonderful things they expect. And I think that keeps us from actually living in the moments, in the good times and the bad times, and simply dealing with them as they are. So that's my answer to it. Anyway, Rich?
In Hebrews 12, 5 through 11, where it talks about, you know, disciplines us as he does as his son, as a father disciplines his son.
Right.
And it's kind of the same thing. It's like we go through things that from our perspective don't seem to make sense or seem to make us feel like we're being punished for something that, you know, and we need to get away from the thought that everything that happens to us, you know, good things will happen, bad things will happen. Mm-hmm. If life happens.
Yeah.
And it's a waste of energy to try to reason out some things. If you get worked up about it, you get over exerted about it, and then it passes, you know. It's like, so what have you gained by all that stress and worry?
Right. Yeah. Essentially, he's told us both the good and the bad come from God. And, you know, you look at the ancient world that didn't really know God, especially people that were into pagan religions, they often felt God was either rewarding them or punishing them. And so they were always trying to give God certain kinds of the right sacrifices so he would like them. And they would send him enough rain. They would have... But the reality is some of those bad things happen even when we're doing all the right things. So that the good and the bad is not simply you're good, you get the good stuff. You're bad, you get the bad stuff. That isn't how it actually works. In fact, we're going to get, he said it here in 15, there is a righteous man who perishes in his righteousness, and there's a wicked man who prolongs his life in evil doing. So in general, right, if we do evil, we're going to reap evil. If we do good, we're going to reap good, right? That's a general principle. Does that always happen? Do sometimes good people receive bad? Yeah, in fact, we're going to look at, I'm going to mention a story, I think, that highlights this pretty well in a moment. But, God is telling us something that's actually quite different than most human religions have kind of created, and that is God is either angry or happy with us, and how what happens to us is dependent upon his mood. And that's just not true. You know, that's a fallacy, and that is a deception that comes from the world. Part of it, I think, he's getting us to understand there are going to be highs and lows to life. Because we've been kicked, our ancestors were kicked out of the garden. The idea of a perfect little world doesn't exist here. And so accepting that to some degree, I was thinking a lot about that in terms of, I don't know, for those who are older in here, do you feel like you kind of accepted life a little bit more than younger people? Just the way life is? That you're a little bit more like, okay, there's protests, there's rioting, there's looting. Some of us are old enough, we've seen it before. Especially, you know, Rodney King in the early 90s, if you're that old, if you're much older, you remember back into the 70s and 60s. if you got 60 years, you've seen at least three times of some pretty severe rioting and burning and looting that have happened in our country. And you're younger, you can't imagine it. Most of the people marching are younger, right? Younger people almost always want to fix everything. This is unacceptable. We can't allow this to happen anymore. We're going to fix this problem. They want that to happen. Now, older people would go, that'd be great. That'd be awesome. I'm not terribly expecting it, but if it happens, that'd be great. But let's say we're able to do it. We were able to fix all the racism, all the prejudice, all the police violence, and we never had anybody ever happen again, any of those things. Would that be the end of problems? Would we have no more? Or would they be coming out another way? So it's actually kind of depressing for young people to realize you're not going to change the world. Because the world kind of is what it is. You can kind of work and try to, you know, do some good things in your time and your place. do all that the world is and all the evil of it, right? And I can actually kind of remember the point in my life when I kind of realized that, and it's a little depressing. And so I'm sorry for you young people to try to depress you. But and if you haven't had that moment where you feel a little depressed about the fact you're not going to, you know, fix the world and save the world and right all the wrong in the world, yeah, most young people have had that in their lives. Any other thoughts on kind of the adversity and prosperity? Okay. So, who remembers the story of Naboth and his vineyard? So we had a handful of people. Remember, Naboth has the vineyard that Ahab wants. He wants to buy it from him. And Naboth's like, no, I don't want to sell it. It's my land. It's his family's land, right? Their land was not, they didn't go buy their land. Their land was given to them, to their family. And it was always in their family. So he wasn't selling it. But Ahab wanted it. So Ahab goes, home and pouting and can't get his way. And his wife Jezebel says to him, why are you so upset? He wouldn't sell his vineyard. And so he's like, oh, I can take care of that. And so she sets up a nice big party. And let's put Naboth at the head of it. We're going to invite all these people in. We're going to put him at the head of the table. And we're going to have a big party in his name. And in the meantime, she has gone to a couple of wicked men. And she has told them, she probably paid them, you need to come in and say that you saw him blaspheme God. I think it's blaspheme God. And so they end up doing that. They lie. He's convicted and he's killed. Now Naboth is a righteous guy. Ahab's not. Who ended up with the land? Ahab did. Not Naboth. Not Naboth's family. In fact, as soon as Naboth was dead, Ahab went down and took his land. Well, he's dead. I'm just going to go take it. The righteous man actually suffered. The wicked man actually prospered, at least in that moment. And that's kind of what I think he's talking about. He says, I've seen this. He goes, there's a righteous man who perishes in his righteousness. There are really good people who even in their goodness, or maybe even because of their goodness, perish and die. And there are really wicked people who live long lives. And inflict a lot of pain on other people. That's the reality of life. Right? Again, isn't that a little depressing? Kind of know that. This guy's the king who's telling, the king with all authority and all power and all wisdom that has, and the most that has ever existed, could not fix all of that. If the king couldn't fix all of it, what are you and I going to do? We're certainly not going to fix all of it. All we can do is our part, right? We can keep practicing righteousness, and we can keep trying to influence that on those around us, and spread, the fruit of the Spirit from our lives and have it drop on other people's lives. But we can't control what they do with it, how they respond to it. We don't have that much power. When the king can't control all that stuff, you and I certainly can't control all those things. So that's kind of what reminded me of that righteous man perishing and the wicked kind of prospering, so that was the example I thought of. You might think of other examples like that as well. Any thoughts or questions about that idea though of the righteous dying and the wicked not? Basically. they don't get their just desserts. They don't get what they have coming. They don't get, you know, they don't reap what they sow always in this life. Sometimes they reap what they don't deserve.
But I think that, you know, when we go back and we see in Hebrews chapter 4, it talks about, you know, the Sabbath rest. You know, and the idea is we are not going to have heaven on earth. You know, and that's what I think a lot of these young people feel, is that if we fix it, it would be so much better.
Right.
And this idea of utopian society. Mm-hmm.
Right.
You know, that's not going to happen in this world, because this world is corrupt.
Right. And I think, I think I mentioned it to you, I mentioned it in a lesson a while back. Expectations often drive discouragement. So if you're expecting to make everything perfect when you're a young person, and young people often have this expectation, they're going to right all the wrongs from previous generations, they're going to fix all those things that are a problem in the world, they're going to feed all the people who are hungry in the world, we're going to do all these wonderful things, right? We're going to take care of all this stuff. And you can do some of that. But we're not going to solve everything, because this world isn't solvable to the point of making everything right. And when you have that expectation, now you go, okay, I'm just going to do what I can. I'm going to do what I'm able. What can I do? I'll do that. And that will have to be enough. And so when you change your expectations, then you have joy. But a lot of times, if your expectations are too high, especially for this world, you're going to end up with being disappointed. In fact, as you were saying that, I was really thinking about the song Imagine by John Lennon. Why religious people hated his song so much. You guys know the song Imagine? Imagine there's no heaven. And everybody's, you know, living for today, and everybody's, you know, there's joy and peace and kumbaya, right? It's just wonderful. We have heaven on earth. It's kind of what this song's about. Don't worry about heaven. Let's just have wonderful now, here and now. That and a lot of people from the world love that idea, right? Because they want to have it here. They don't have expectations of something wonderful after. So they want to get it now. They want to get as much good as they can right now. But for the person who knows God, the person who understands what God has told us and understands the world and the place the world has in all of his creation, well, you're kind of barking up the wrong tree. Quit imagining there's no heaven. Imagine there's a heaven. And start living like there's one, and you want to go. That would be a whole lot better world, wouldn't it? If more people were living like there was really a heaven and practicing that, it doesn't mean we wouldn't have sin. We're still sinners. We still fall, and we still do things sometimes that we don't want to do, and even when we're trying to do the right thing. If we imagine there was a heaven and we were trying to live in such a way to be worthy of that calling to go, then we'd have a much better place. So that John Lennon's song Imagine is really the world's vision of trying to make heaven on earth, I think. And that's what that's what came to my mind as you were talking about that. Okay. Any other thoughts on that? Okay. So this next little part in this section, I think is worded in kind of a strange way. And I don't know if you guys think, be not overly righteous. Do not make yourself too wise. What do you think that, what does that mean? Because if you just take that really literally, right? Well, I shouldn't try to keep growing in my wisdom. I've kind of gotten a certain amount, and it's like, it wouldn't be good for me to get more. Does that sound like the appropriate way to think of that, though? I shouldn't get more wise? Because that would go against the concept of 2 Peter 1, that I would keep growing, right? That I would continue to grow in faith and knowledge and all of this. And so if that's not what it is, what is it? If it's not really literal saying, well, only get so wise, only get so righteous, and then stop. What do you think?
I think he's talking in a fully worldly context. Because he says, don't be, I almost view it as self-righteous.
Mm-hmm.
That I'm full of myself, and I'm the best, and I'm the smartest, or whatever. Because the next verse says, or don't be overly foolish.
Mm-hmm.
Don't go to the complete other extreme,
right.
Ignorant. And then at the end of the third verse of the section, mm-hmm. It says, the one who fears God will... He who fears God will escape them all, or he's going to be the one that doesn't suffer from what the overly righteous does, and the worldly sense of being overly foolish does.
Yeah. Yeah, I think self-righteousness is kind of a big part of that. Do not be overly righteous or make yourself too wise. And I think part of what he's saying is don't think of yourself as too wise. You know, don't think of yourself as I've got all the answers. And that, because that becomes kind of prideful, arrogant, right? It becomes, if I think I have all the answers, what do I do as far as listening to others? So I cease listening, right? I cease to learn. I cease to grow because I think I know it all. And so I think you make a really good point about this as being essentially a self-righteousness, so that he's warning us of acting and demonstrating ourselves as we've got it all figured out, that I know it all. That is something we need to avoid. You know, being that person who just knows everything. But then on the other hand, don't be overly wicked. Neither be a fool. What does he mean there? Because that almost sounds like, well, you could be a little wicked. A little wicked, not bad. Don't be overly wicked, because doesn't that read that way? Don't be too wicked. You can be just the right amount of wicked. Do you think that's what he's saying? Doesn't that also sound weird? That's why you guys were laughing. Because when you say it that way, it's like, well, that sounds really weird. To say, oh, I guess I could be a little wicked. But the reality is, don't a lot of religious people kind of think that way? A little sin won't hurt. Now, am I barking up the wrong tree, or do you think you see people who are religious-minded who think that way? Yeah, I think I saw one shaking of the head, yes. You guys see that kind of as something that happens?
The idea of, like, white lies.
White lies, yeah.
It's a lie,
but it's a good lie.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I think other times, I think he's warning. What do you think he's warning? If he's not telling us, okay, it's okay to be a little wicked, what do you think he's actually warning us about in terms of being wicked or being a fool? So I think, and think about the two ends. So he already talked about it. It's one is self-righteousness, proud, arrogant, knows everything. Well, what do some people do that's completely the opposite of that?
Hashtag YOLO.
YOLO, that's a good one. Hashtag YOLO. You only live once. Yeah, this stupid thing I'm doing might cause me to die, but oh well, only live once. Their ignorance and foolishness just kind of, and they use it as an excuse. when I think of naive, I often think of people who don't have the ability to really get it, because they're not old enough, wise enough in some way. And so in some ways, I think it's kind of what it's almost I can't think of the phrase I usually use. But there's an ignorance, but that's willful ignorance. That, yeah, okay, I could know, but I don't want to know. I just want to keep doing what I'm doing. I just want to keep, I'm just going to keep living and doing.
Ignorance is bliss.
Yeah. And I think that's kind of the other extent. And some people really do, especially if they reject wisdom and they just kind of headlong go in after foolishness. They're like, I'm just going to dive into this then. I'm just going to get as much as I can to it. And so, it made me think of a brother who, having been gone from the church for, a couple of decades, told me, after he returned, that he really, because he didn't stop believing in God, he was worse than worldly people. Because he believed he was against God. And he's just like, I'm against God, so whatever. What more can God do to me? I'll just keep doing bad. Because he had a mindset that God was against him. He was going to go to hell. He believed that. And he's like, he didn't believe, though, that there were a bunch of different layers of hell. So he's like, I'm already going there. What does it matter what I do? And so some people just kind of just, they hug evil. In fact, I think we see this, and not only in the current rioters and looters, you see this from time to time. Back Rodney King, the riots that happened, you see people, and there's video of people just reveling in not only just stealing, but also in hurting people. Occasionally you see video of somebody who has been beaten or hurt, and sometimes to the point of death or sometimes to death, and people around are rejoicing. And they actually don't have anything personally against this person. They don't even know. And I think that's kind of that idea, that, because I think some of those people, and I think some of them probably later go, man, what was I doing? But some of them probably have just embraced wickedness. And if they can get away with it, they're going to get away with it. And so he's warning us, I think, from just kind of, okay, well, I can't be too wise, so I'm just going to do whatever. But much like the whole book, right? This book, I think more than most books in the Bible, is not about perfection. It's just about finding the better way to practice life. It's in many ways, Ecclesiastes is a very common sense type of book, isn't it? Almost like Proverbs. It's kind of just like, this is the best way to live in this world. This isn't a great world. Everything's not perfect in this world. You can't make it perfect. You can simply do your best. And these are the better things to do. Don't try to be all-knowing, and don't try to be all-evil. Avoid those things. Try to do your best. That's kind of what I grasp from it. So, any other thoughts on... and as he ends it, though... But because the person who fears God, who respects God and understands that God's going to hold me to account, that's the person who will be taken care of. Because wisdom, especially from a worldly sense of wisdom, lots of smart people in the world who are not on God's side. So just being smart and just having a lot of knowledge, that is not going to make it okay and make everything work out and make your end profitable. What's going to make your end profitable is respecting and honoring God. That's ultimately what gives us a way through all of this mess. So, thoughts? on the end of that section. We'll move on to the last section. I guess I could skip the very last little, you know, handful of verses. I would probably avoid getting myself in trouble, but I'm probably going to get myself in trouble anyway. Because I'm trying to count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 7, 8, 9, 10, 13. Let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 of us. Okay. I don't know if you just noticed, but I counted 13 women and 7 men. So, if you haven't already read ahead, we'll see who I get in trouble with in a second. Okay, so starting in verse 19. Wisdom gives strength to the wise man more than 10 rulers who are in a city. Surely there is not a righteous man on earth who does good and never sins. Verse 20 is, I think, a real key thing to just understand life. No matter how good somebody is that you might respect or think a lot of out there, don't think they're not sinners. No matter how good they are. That goes to people who preach, it goes to people, you know, who are elders, because very often, if we have the expectation that these people are perfect, without their flaws, without their sins, when they let us down, it's terribly disappointing. And so, but the truth is, if you're around somebody long enough, everybody disappoints you at some point, right? If you're close enough to them, because we're human beings. And we don't always do the right thing. We don't always act the right way. And so having that sense about people, because people do, when they see some great person fall and just, oh, wow, that person was doing all that. All of a sudden you're there. Like, for example, how many people, when you first heard Bill Cosby being accused of raping and drugging and raping a lot of women, was your first reaction, oh, yeah, I can see that? Was your reaction like mine? Like, I can't imagine him doing that. And I kind of went, my reaction also after thinking that was, I can't imagine him doing that, was also, but I don't know him. I've seen him on TV shows. That doesn't mean I know him. I lived long enough to realize it could be true. I wasn't making it true automatically. But my initial reaction, that didn't seem like him. And yet, he's been convicted. And I don't know all the sordid details of all of it, but he's been convicted, been in jail now for quite a number of years, and most likely die in jail. But that was kind of the last one I could think of somebody that, wow, that's a fall. But they didn't have that image. Hard to imagine it. And then people kind of like, well, if they're not wonderful, who is? Well, the truth is, there are good people. But those good people still have flaws. And they don't always do good. Sometimes they do wrong stuff. And we need to kind of have that. That's a good realization. It's kind of helping us understand this world. Then 21. Do not take to heart all things that people say, lest you hear your servant cursing you. Your heart knows that many times you yourself have cursed others. 21 has been one of the most helpful verses. I told you this is one of my favorite chapters in the Bible. This chapter has helped me understand and relate to people in a much better way. You ever notice kind of what media it does now? Especially social media, something's out there, and then news, you go, once something's out there, then all the media has to go to somebody, well, do you know what somebody said about you? And you got to get your response to what somebody said about you. Because that's what a lot of news has become, right? Somebody has said something, and now I've got to get their reaction. And he's like, and what he's telling us to do is kind of go, But what humans do, well, I know what I always did as a young person, young man, is I want to fire back. I want to talk to him. I want to get set it straight. And reality is, he's kind of like telling you, you really don't take that to heart. So somebody comes, oh, do you know what so-and-so said about you? The best reaction is, whatever. Doesn't really matter. Well, I thought they were your friend. Have you never said anything that a friend... Have you never said something to somebody about somebody else that that other person wouldn't have liked? Not a single person in this room, if you're old enough, has ever not done that. We have all said something to somebody, and that's kind of exactly what he's telling us. We have all cursed. Cursing is not swearing. You know, using foul language, it's saying, it's speaking against. It's saying something negative about somebody. We have all said something negative about somebody to others. And very often we've even said that about people who are our friends, our family, our loved ones. And if they kind of like come at you and went, I can't believe you said that. It's like, oh, yeah. Well, that came out worse than I meant it. And a lot of times it does. If you say something, it kind of ends up coming out worse. It sounds a whole lot worse than what you might have intended. But you actually said it. And so he's telling you. This is my way of stating this verse. Don't worry about what other people say about you. Just go on living your life. And don't worry about what other people say about you. If somebody wants to help you, teach you, or correct you in some way with wisdom, be open and acceptable to that. But if people are talking, try to ignore it. And don't respond to it. Just let it be. Because you can understand, you've said things too about people. And if you are called to the carpet for everything you ever said about anybody ever, How much part of your life would you spend explaining yourself? We'd spend a lot of our life explaining every negative thing we've said about somebody. And so he's telling us, really don't try to just push that off. And it's easier said than done. And I think a lot of times it has to continually be pushed off. But I found that just a tremendous help for me. That verse has meant a lot to me. And just, oh, well. You know, because I actually, first church I was really a member of for a long time, there were whispers about me from a few people who got upset at me, and people were insinuating things without saying things, and I realized people were kind of talking, and I never said and did a thing. And I actually had somebody, one person, like 3-4 years later, because some of the people talking and saying things they were kind of insinuating about me, their lives became a real dumpster fire, right? My life didn't become a dumpster fire. And, you know, the one person who was open to me a few years later said, well, I eventually saw it, that what they were saying about you wasn't true. But it took years of just being me and knowing people were kind of insinuating things. And if I had even gone to the people insinuating things, they probably would have said, oh, they're not really. Oh, no, that's not what I meant. And so a lot of times you can't even defend, because how do you defend yourself when against a negative, like, because there's how do you prove those things didn't happen? It's not like I wasn't ever around them and they couldn't have happened. It just didn't happen, and it certainly, whatever might have happened, certainly didn't happen to what they pretended it was. And so, anyway, it was... It was very, very painful, a few years for me. But in the end, people respected me and didn't respect the people who said it. But that took 3 or 4 years. So, you know, sometimes that's how long it takes to kind of, you know, overcome things that things negative said about us. But it really does work. So, Okay. Says, now this last section, okay, we have, so this last section is all about wisdom. Looking for and testing wisdom, seeking to be wise. He even says, but it was far from me. That which has been is far off and deep, very deep. Who can find it out? So he's like, who can have all this wisdom? Who can know all this stuff? He's like, yeah, I don't have it. And here's this person with great wisdom saying, there's too much to know. I don't know all this. And so he's going to kind of talk about turning his heart to know and to search out and to seek wisdom and the scheme of things. The scheme of things actually is a phrase that means the sum total of things. It's actually a math phrase for them. And it actually means to kind of total things up. And so he's looking for the scheme. What is the scheme? What's the whole big plan? What is the thing that kind of sums all this up? And so he's looking for wisdom and he's looking for those schemes. And to understand wickedness and folly and foolishness and madness. So he's kind of looking at those two things he's already been talking about, but he's looking at trying to understand wisdom and foolishness and try to know it. And he's already telling us, boy, I'm missing a lot of it and I'm not seeing a lot of it. So he's already kind of telling us that to some degree. And then he's going to give us just some examples of that here as we end. He says, and I find something more bitter than death. The woman whose heart is snares and nets and whose hands are fetters. He who pleases God escapes her, but the sinner is taken by her. So fetters are essentially like handcuffs or manacles on the legs. That's what fetters are. So he's actually saying one of the things that he has seen that's actually even worse than dying is essentially being caught and ensnared by a woman whose heart, which really takes up, remember, heart really takes up not only kind of a sense of emotion, but really of thinking, of rationalizing, reasoning. But it really kind of combines them. And so she is more, I think what we would use is manipulative, right? I think that would be the term we would use. That she gets hold of things, twists them, turns them, manipulates them, gets them in her net. And he says that the one who pleases God escapes. Now, I don't think he's saying by their own wisdom, because they, you know, God has granted them so much wisdom. I think he's actually telling us that God actually helps us, and essentially avoid getting caught in traps. But if we fear Him and we listen to Him, that He actually helps us in this. But and then this, but the sinner is taken by her. So first off, like I said, so you have a lot of women here, a handful of guys. What do you think this is talking about? What is he describing that especially men avoiding this particular woman? What does this look like in our world? Yeah. Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he certainly, and you know, because the scriptures tell us that Solomon's heart was turned by a lot of women, by the women that he had in his life, his thousand different wives had turned his heart. He built, you know, he built idols and temples for them and for them to worship their gods and things. And he did a lot of things that he never should have done, but he did them for women. We see that with Samson, right? He gets brought down, not because somebody was stronger or wiser. He got brought down by a woman, didn't he? He got ensnared and caught and trapped because he, Now, the book, it's interesting because you have this section kind of describing some women that, boy, you don't want any part of. But this book also describes women that you do want in your life, right? So, thinking more of Proverbs 31, not this book. But he's warning us here about something. And I don't know, do the women out here in the audience, does this read in Scripture like, wow, this doesn't sound good about women? So how do you read it? How do you take it? Do you, man?
Mm-hmm. Why do women always want that kind of guy instead of a good mm-hmm. guy? I think that's not, he's a man, he wrote this, mm-hmm. and I think he's talking about, like Debbie says, the kind of things people need to counter. Mm-hmm. But I think from the other viewpoint, there's a lot of women looking at going, why is that kind of woman always good at scaring men? Mm-hmm. And I think maybe the same thing, why is that kind of guy always good mm-hmm. at scaring men?
Right. Yeah. Go ahead, I'll go to you and then go to him.
When I read passages like this, I see it as I take it as a warning as a woman that I don't want to be that kind of woman.
Mm-hmm.
That I want to be one that encourages my husband in his love of God or the other men around me and not be one that's a temptress mm-hmm. that's trying to pull them away.
Mm-hmm.
So I read it as a warning,
right.
as a lesson to me to not be that kind of
woman. Okay, good. What are you going to say, Rich? Because scripture does, it does imply that women may struggle with nagging, right? Not every woman. But I think one of the things that she's saying is that I think one of the things we have to look at when we look at sections that are specifically telling men something, male something, and women something, I think the scriptures, because you don't generally see them overlap a lot. I think the scriptures really hit at our weaknesses, what our weaknesses are. And so they are kind of a warning to each of us that we have certain things we have to be careful about and that are kind of more common. They're not unique to one gender or another, but they're more commonly a problem of one gender or another. And so he's kind of hitting, well, he talked about persistence,
yeah.
Much nicer way than saying nagging. Yeah, he's like, yeah, you better live on the corner of the rooftop than be with that woman.
Yeah, so there are persistency issues. Things that might make your life miserable.
Right.
And that's what he's warning against there.
Right. So like Jennifer, you mentioned earlier, why do women and men struggle to, why do they often get ensnared by wrong type of people for them? Especially, you talk about good men and women, why do they get ensnared by people who are maybe more manipulative? Maybe because we actually don't, good people tend maybe not understand the manipulations as much. But both in Proverbs and, here in Ecclesiastes, Because remember, the Proverbs 31 is written to a young man. It's actually not written to women. Women can certainly take it and, you know, try and glean from it. But the passage is actually written to men to help them know what to look for. And also, in Proverbs, know what to avoid. What kind of things are you trying to stay away from? What kinds of things are you... And so all of that is, he's telling us that we can really injure each other. And here he's kind of focusing on the woman, not that there aren't times in other passages that focus on men, but he's telling that this is actually something that we have to be careful of if we want to be godly. And especially men out there, if you want to be godly, you really have to be aware of this. So I know as a young man, I didn't understand these passages really at all. Especially before as a Christian, but even as a brand new Christian, I didn't really understand a lot of these passages in Proverbs to really understand what to look for and what to avoid. And also what the signs of those things were. Because nobody comes out and tells you they're those things. No. But I was thinking, I was kind of interested, you said you try to avoid it. Because do you think, do the women here think that all of you could be this? Do you think women, as women, you have the power to manipulate men?
Absolutely. I didn't used to think that, but as I've gotten older and being married, I realized that at least one man I certainly have.
Yeah.
You look around and see it.
Right. So you may not be manipulative. And if you're a good woman, you won't try to be manipulative. But I think most women can manipulate men.
And most men are susceptible to it.
And most men are susceptible to it. Absolutely. And it isn't just wives. It's daughters. It can happen to a lot of us in a lot of different ways. So it is... That wasn't a commentary. But... It happens, you know. I'm talking to a number of guys here who have a lot of daughters, right? So, you know, we have one man in this, no, two guys now have one son each. But all the rest of the men in here have all daughters. So I think we all know what we're talking about. So.
And it's more bitter than death.
Yeah. So, okay, so we're going to end here. We have a song we're going to do. I just wanted to do the last thing, and maybe a quick thought about this. One man among a thousand I found, a woman among all these I have not found. Which is interesting when he's talking about this idea of searching for wisdom. We don't think about this. When we think about wise, and we think about godliness, do we think women are more godly than men? Well, if we ask the question this way, who goes to church more, women or men? Women do. It's easy. But if the truth is that women aren't generally more godly than men, there may be a reason women are drawn to religion that isn't about God. Are they more drawn to the community and the support and the network and not as much God himself? I don't know. I'm asking the question. I've been thinking about why is those two things seem just different? Because very often we think, well, women are the more godly. They're the more, you know, the wiser. And yet he's not saying that here. Now he's obviously, so if he searched 1,000 men and 1,000 women and he only found one man, he's not saying that there's many people out there with great wisdom. But why did he say there was one man in 1,000 and no women? This is one of those verses that I've never quite understood why he said it the way he said it. Yeah.
I feel like historically speaking, in this time, the only way a woman could advance in society was mm-hmm. to get a man, and a lot of times that probably required a lot of manipulation, and so it may have been just almost a cultural thing too, mm-hmm. that women were more apt to be not desperate, but that was their only way
yeah.
to have a living and to be cared for
sure.
and to survive.
Yeah, you know, a lot of that cultural stuff would certainly have affected them. You know, women needing, and the societies being very different. Women, you know, women's roles, men's roles were often much more distinct and very different. And that would have, and yet scriptures don't tell us. It does show us a number of wise women, even though they're married to men who maybe even aren't wise, you know. And we also, but so with Jezebel, we also get Abigail, right? So we have Jezebel who's, because when you look at Ahab and Jezebel, Jezebel seems like the real fire of evil in that couple. And I think that's why her name comes all the way into the New Testament too, because he's like, wow, she's renowned for her wickedness and influencing her husband in wickedness, because Ahab didn't kill Elijah, but it was Jezebel who was, I'm going to kill Elijah. And, but then Abigail, who tried to save her husband's life and was wise with a knucklehead husband. And so he's still, we see it in Ruth. So we are shown women of wisdom and faithfulness and honor and all those things. We see them even in the, given all of the restrictions that people had, and kind of they were all in these really set roles. The scriptures still have shown us a lot of different characters, and yet he says this here. It just seems like an odd thing, but he is, the big emphasis though is that wisdom is actually quite rare. Real wisdom is not common. So, okay. Do you say?
I do wonder if this is a personal commentary, because he did have 1,000 women, and tying that back to verse 26, I find it more bitter than death.
Yeah. And well, certainly he's told us from the beginning, he has given us advice from his life and what he has learned. And so it's certainly what he has found, yes. And one among 1,000. I guess, is that why you had 1,000 wives? He's like, I'm trying to find one?
I'm trying to find the wise one. I think he's considering himself the wise man.
I found one.
1,000 women.
1,000 men. I just only found one wise guy. I tried to find 1,000.
How wise was he? Because he wasn't wise in his marriage.
No, he wasn't. No, he wasn't so wise. But okay. So we're going to sing a song to close out. Dave will lead us in that song. He'll also close us in prayer. Appreciate your time tonight, and I feel somewhat unscathed in getting through that passage, so we'll end there. And Dave, what song are we singing? 874 in our hymn books, because we don't have that many yet in our supplements, but so 874, let's go ahead and stand and sing.
Walking alone at even, hearing the stars afar, then the darkness comes to a heavy silver star. I have a great delight in the wonderful scenes above. God in His power and might is showing His truth and love. Oh, for a home with God, a place in His courts to rest. Sure.
Father in heaven, almighty you are, and we look to you very much and wonder often how you could love us. And we thank you for that love. We thank you for Jesus Christ and the sacrifice that was given for us to redeem us, to forgive us of our sins, and to look forward to spending an eternity with you, Father. We ask that you would be with us, help us to be strong, help us to live well in this world. Father, we pray for peace. We pray for peace across the United States. Help us in this nation to actually really truly come together and to live a more peaceful life. Help us to all want to look to you and live according to your will, to live as Christians. Be with us, Father, as we're out in the world, that we would be an example while we're out there. Help us to be safe also. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.